Okay, so one second, I finish cleaning here. So now with a bit more caffeine, we can go on. So we arrived at the Monge-Ampère equation, which is there on the top. Of course, you see, I've written that equation formally because I assumed that I had enough regularity to do the computations. But this looks a bit like the chicken and egg because I want to prove regularity using Monge-Ampère equation and then I needed regularity to write it. So it's not clear how it goes. So really this was more motivational so to write it down, but in fact you cannot really use it because you don't have enough regularity to write it. So the question of regularity, so we are in the quadratic cost for the moment, is suppose that f and g are super nice, c infinity, does this imply that t is nice in some sense, the transport map? Okay, and then the answer is actually easy to give. So consider this case, you have a nice unit ball in B1 in the plane. You put, let's say, density F equal 1. Okay, it's not a probability density, but okay, doesn't matter, I just normalize it. And then here, as a target measure, I take two half disks. So let's say this is the origin. And this is one. This is one. Then I put one and one here. So g equal one, g equal one. So the transport map here is easy to write. T of x is x plus. So what happens is that the bottom part of the disk goes up and the lower part of the disk goes down. So sine of x2 times e2. So if you're in a point x here, so this is e1, e2. So if you're in a point x with x2 positive, you do x plus e2. And if you're in a point x with x2 negative, you go down. And so this is the gradient of phi, where phi is x squared over 2 plus modulus of x2. Which is a nice complex function. And of course, this is not very regular. Now, this is not surprising because you are trying to map a connected set onto a disconnected set. So for topological reason, you cannot do it with a continuous map. So here the issue is that the support of G is disconnected. Then you would say, okay, let me make it connected. But, so what has been noticed by Caffarelli almost 30 years ago is that if you take f equal 1 and now g equal 1 in a domain like this, where you add a very small strip to connect the two half balls, then you have a map T epsilon. And for epsilon small enough, the epsilon is not C0. So the kind of phenomenon you will have is that, so there will be points here which are mapped on the top and points here which are mapped to the bottom. And you have a singularity. So these are bad news. But then the question is, what's happening? So why this is happening? So in the 40s, there was a notion of weak solution for Monge-Ampère introduced in the 1940s, which was kind of different. So let me give you another definition. This is essentially due to Alexandrov. So I will say that phi is an Alexandrov solution. of determinant d squared phi equal f over g of grad phi if the following goes. For every set E inside X, I look at the following object. I look at the volume of this set, some differential of phi at E. I will explain this. And this must be equal to the integral of E of F divided by G of grad phi. Dx, whatever. So this is a definition. Now, what is this left-hand side? Where? So, subdifferential of phi of E is the union over x in E of the subdifferential of phi at a point x. And then remember that the subdifferential of phi at x is the set of vectors p such that phi of z is greater or equal than phi of x plus p z minus x for every z. So it means that you have a convex function, phi, you have a point x, and then you have a linear function. At every point of a convex function, there are, you know that the graph of a convex, let's say the graph of a convex function is touched from below by lines, by affine hyperplanes. And p is the gradient of these affine functions. So at each point, this set is non-empty. It could be one point, it could be more than one point. For instance, if there is a singularity, so if phi is like this, you have a lot of possible affine planes that touch from below. And then you look at the volume of the image of this set. So this is a definition. Let me make a remark. If phi is C2, then the volume of this set, this is, well, the phi is the function is differentiable, so the subdifferential is just the gradient. So this is the image of E through the gradient. And then by the change of variable formula, this is the integral over E of the determinant of the gradient of the gradient of phi, which is dash. And so you see that I'm just writing that the integral of the determinant over E is equal to the integral of F over G over E. So I'm just writing in a weak sense this equality. So this is another notional weak solution, which is not a priori connected to optimal transport. And in fact, it's not, because now if you look at this case, let's look at the first case. So in the first case, again, this one, look, the function phi was x squared over 2 plus modulus of x2. And remember, f was 1 and g was 1. So here I should put 1. And now you can do an exercise where you compute the subdifferential of this line. So you can compute the subdifferential of phi of the line minus 1, 1 cross 0. This is the line where this function is a singularity. And I invite you to do this exercise. You'll try to find all the planes that are below. And this set is the set minus 1, 1 square. All the vectors there are in the subdifferential. And so you see that the volume of the subdifferential of this set is the volume of this, which is 4, minus 1, 1 square. So it's, but this is a set of measure 0. Measure 0. It's a line. I mean, it's a segment. So you see that this property is false in this case, because if E has measure 0, the subdifferential of phi of E should be the integral of something over E, and if G is measure 0, this will be 0. While here I get 4. So phi is not an Alexandrov solution. So what I'm telling you is that the optimal transport map satisfies the Monge-Ampère equation in some weak form. Usually people call it's a Brenier solution of Monge-Ampère. And what we're saying here is that Brenier solution is not Alexandrov solution. It's a weaker notion. But the theorem that Caffarelli proved in 91, he said if the support of G is convex, then Brenier solution implies Alexandrov solution. So to avoid this kind of counterexamples, it's not enough to assume connectedness. You really need convex. But the moment it's convex, you can do it. You can prove that every Alexandrov solution, every Brenier solution is an Alexandrov solution. So in other words, any optimal transport map give rise to an Alexandrov solution. That's what I'm saying. Okay? And then you have to start to work the regularity theory of Alexandrov solutions. So in a sense, once you are here, you say, okay, now I only worry about this notion. This is a very nice notion to be regularity. And the kind of theorem that one can prove is that, for instance, if the support of G is convex, and let's say that F is between two constants, lambda and 1 over lambda inside X, and G is also between two constants in Y, then the map T is C0 alpha, for instance, locally in X. So you have an homeomorphism. And then if you have more regularity on F and G, you get more regularity on T. Furthermore, let's say F and G are regular. Let's say if they are C0 alpha, then T is C1 alpha. So you gain some regularity. The way you should think about it is like an elliptic regularity. If f and z are c0 alpha, then phi, the solution phi, the convex function is c2 alpha, it gains two derivatives, like what will happen for the Laplacian, right? So Monge-Ampère is determinant of the Hessian f over g. For the Laplacian is c0 alpha means the solution is c2 alpha. So right hand side c0 alpha means c2 alpha. And then T is the gradient, so you lose one derivative in T. So T is gradient of phi. Okay, so this is kind of the how the story goes. Of course, so this is kind of delicate theory that requires a lot of work. If you're interested, actually, I wrote a book on Monge-Ampère. So it's called The Monge-Ampère Equation and Its Applications. So there I explain everything. But here, of course, I don't have time for entering into the details. I would just want to give you more of an overview of what you can do. So the one thing you can ask the moment you see this theorem, especially from the point of view of optimal transport, is the following. Okay, very nice. If the target is convex, I have regularity. But what if the target is not convex? So, okay, I showed you that there is a counterexample, but the counterexample is not too bad in the sense that, yeah, there is a singularity, but like in this case, for instance, the singularity is happening on a segment. So here the optimal transport is smooth, here the optimal transport is smooth. And then there is a line singularity here, which where the optimal transport breaks. Let's say there is a discontinuity. So in some sense, you could ask, okay, how standard is to see something like that? Can I see something about the singular set, the set where the transport is discontinuous. So this is something actually I've been thinking about for quite some time. And in the context of the quadratic cost, so classical Monge-Ampère, let's say one result that I proved almost 10 years ago together with Yang and Kim, who is here, is the following theorem. So without any assumption on the geometry, so this is myself and Yang and Kim, what we proved is that if you take, let's say, omega, and let's say f is between lambda and 1 over lambda in a domain X, and g is between lambda and 1 over lambda on a domain Y, and no assumption on X and Y. Let's say the only thing getting, X and Y open sets. I think that we assume that the boundary of X and boundary of Y have no measure, so these are not pathological open sets. The boundary of the set has measure zero. Then there exist two sets, sigma 1 and sigma 2. So sigma 1 contained in X, sigma 2 contained in Y, such that They both have measure zero. And if I look at the transport map from X minus sigma 1 on Y minus sigma 2, this is a homeomorphism. So you can remove two sets of measure zero, and after you remove them, you get an homeomorphism. And then if you put more regularity on F and G, you get a diffeomorphism. So the same as for Caffarelli. So just to give you a sense, just to give two examples. So in the first example would be like this case. In this case, when you want to map a ball into two half disks, sigma 1 will be this. This is sigma 1. And then you see that the transport map is a homeomorphism in each piece. So that's the obvious thing. Something a bit more interesting, maybe. Suppose that my domain is something like this. It's not convex, maybe. And I'm mapping it, let's see, in something like this. So the kind of picture you should have in mind, let's see, some color. So, first in this direction. So I want a homeomorphism. So usually something like this will create usually some singularity here. So let's say maybe a singularity here. Not every bump has to create a singularity, but if you think about this case, even when you put a bridge, the fact that there was a hole here was creating a singularity. So maybe this one creates a singularity like this. Actually, let me be a bit more. Let me put even a hole. I'm not asking some simply connected or anything. So maybe there is a hole. So the fact that there is a hole will create a singularity here, let's say. So the transport map maps this hole here. So if you are here on the top, you are here. And if you are here on the bottom, you are below the hole. So the hole is in the target. And then maybe there are singularities coming backward. So maybe what could happen? In this case, actually, let me make it a bit nicer. Like this, almost, doesn't matter. I mean, this is very almost flat. What could happen is that maybe a point here and a point here are mapped very close by. And then this will create a singularity here. In the sense that points here, if I look it in the inverse will send this point here and this point here. So this fact of non-convexity, So the non-convexity in the target creates singularity here, but the non-convexity in the source will create singularity here. And so the kind of picture is that, okay, maybe I remove this line, this some curve here, and a curve here. And after I remove this, I get homeomorphism from this set to this set. That's the kind of thing theorem we have in mind. Now, a very interesting open problem is that, so the following conjecture will be that sigma I have codimension 1. So the theorem tells you that sigma 1 and sigma 2 have measure 0. So if you look at all the examples, they rather look like codimension 1 sets. And this is completely open. So at the moment, I don't know how to prove even dimension n minus epsilon. So the theorem will be that these sets have dimension n minus 1. The only thing we know is that they have measure 0. So there is a one gap of one dimension. But even dimension n minus epsilon, at the moment, I don't know how to prove it. So this is something. Okay, so this is what, but still, I mean, at least you can do that. You throw away sets of measure 0, and you get. Oh. Okay, so in dimension 2, you can play a bit better. You can actually prove a nice structure theorem. In particular, you can prove that these kind of curves are C1 in general. So you can get a very nice stratification result. In some sense, still on the closure, you don't have the codimension 1 estimate. So you get a very strong information on how these curves behave. So at the moment, the way I drew it, so if you look at the paper with Yang et al., only says that you have measure 0. And it doesn't say anything on the structure. If you're in dimension 2, you can really say that this picture is what's happening. So there are nice C1 curves that kind of create that. But the problem is that, okay, if the picture was really this, then you will get the result. But the problem is that maybe these curves could bifurcate. I mean, maybe the singular set is made of curves that start to bifurcate. And then what you can say is that the closure of all these curves has measure 0. But I don't know if the closure has dimension minus 1. But and then all this piece of curve is C1 regular. So that's something actually proved in 2008, a bit before. But it works really only in dimension 2. OK, so to be honest, I think in dimension 2 now I have almost a guess that I think I'm optimistic I can prove the in dimension 2 the n minus 1. But okay, I think I had, I don't know, probably 6 or 7 false proofs of that theorem. So I'm not making any claim at the moment. But okay, in higher dimension, this is another issue. Okay, so this is something I think which would be very interesting to understand. Now let me make another point. I would like to show you some proof rather than keeping list results. And there is a beautiful result by Caffarelli that I really like, whose proof is rather elementary. And it has nice applications, and then it also will come out when you try, I mean, the kind of techniques also come out when you try to work with general cost. So I would like to show you a result which is called Caffarelli contraction theorem. So Caffarelli contraction theorem, so this is a theorem in 2000. And what Luis did was to say, okay, let me consider very special class of measures. I'm going to consider as source measure a Gaussian, so a constant times e to the minus x squared over 2, and then as target measure e to the minus v, where v is convex, and actually the action of v is bounded from below by alpha times the density. Okay? So it not only is convex, it's uniformly convex. So alpha positive. So this is what is called a log concave measure. If you take the log of G, you get a concave function. Because the log of G is minus V, V is convex, so minus V is concave. Okay, and then you look at the optimal transport. So you take T equal grad phi optimal transport. And then you say, okay, let's write Monge-Ampère. So you get determinant of D square phi equal F of X, so a constant Cn e to the minus x squared over 2, divided by g composed with transport map, so e to the minus v times composed with grad phi of x. So this is just the Monge-Ampère equation for this particular case. Okay? Okay, now you look at these exponentials, and you say, okay, let's take a logarithm to make them disappear. So I get log of that of d square phi at x equal log cn, so a constant, minus x squared over 2 plus v of grad phi at x. So this is my PD. So we look at the PD in that way, as log of that. And actually, log of that of the Hessian is a nice operator. More than that, because of the following property. So let F, capital F of M, to be log that of M. So the operator which to a matrix has to a, for M, positive definite. So like here, this is the Hessian of a convex function, so this is a positive definite matrix. And then consider D over D epsilon square of F of M plus epsilon N. So you take your matrix and you differentiate your operator in some direction along some different matrix. So this is a matrix in our n cos n symmetric. Then this is less or equal than zero. It's a property of the operator log of that. Okay, so log composition with that on the set of positive definite matrices is concave. It has second derivative less or equal than zero. So this is a linear algebra fact. It has nothing to do with PDEs, just something about the properties of the determinant. Okay, so this, let me write it in some different way. So this is second derivative of F applied, so evaluated at the point M. Apply that n. Right. So it's the Hessian of f. So f is a function defined on r n cross n. And then you take the Hessian and you evaluate at n. So this Hessian is less or equal than zero. OK, now, so I look at my function here, my Hessian. So I fix a direction. So I fix E a direction on the sphere in n minus 1. And then I look at the max of dE phi at x. So I look at the point where the Hessian of phi attains a maximum. Sorry, not the Hessian. The Hessian of phi in the direction E. So the second partial derivative, dE phi, takes a maximum in Rn. Okay, here you need to work a little to prove, a maximum may not exist. So maybe the maximum, because we are, this is a problem defined in the wall Rn. But let's assume that the maximum exists, and let's see what happens. So let x bar be a maximum point. Then if you have a maximum point for a function, you know that the gradient of dEE of pi at x bar is 0, and the hessian of dEE of phi at x bar is less or equal than 0. Okay? Very well. Now, let's take our PD. This is true everywhere in Rn. So our PD, what is? Our PD tells me that, so I called log of that is f. So our PD tells me that f of the hessian of phi at x is equal to a constant minus x squared over 2 plus v of gradient of phi. So this is true everywhere in Rn. So let me differentiate the PD. I can start to take derivatives. So first I take one derivative. So I take the partial derivative of the PD in the direction E. So I differentiate. So when I take the derivative of this, I get the gradient of f evaluated at the hessian of phi applied to the derivative of that. So this is d square phi, d square d e phi at x bar, at x. This is equal. So the derivative of log cn is 0. The derivative of this in the direction of e, so is minus x dot e. And then plus the gradient of v at grad phi n times the gradient of d phi at x. Okay? Now let's take a second derivative, another derivative. So we get the hessian of f. So when you differentiate this, there is this matrix times this matrix. So either you differentiate this first, and then you get the hessian evaluated at d square phi at x applied to the hessian d phi at x hessian d phi at x, or the derivative falls here, and then you get plus grad f of d square phi at x times the hessian of d e e phi at x. Very well. And now this is equal to the derivative of the right hand side. So when I differentiate x with respect to e, I get e. So I get minus e squared minus 1. E has modulus 1. This will be minus the norm of e squared. Then I differentiate this term. I get plus the hessian of v at grad phi of x applied to grad d phi of x, grad d phi of x, plus the derivative falls here, grad v at grad phi of x hessian of phi e hessian of d e phi of x. So I just differentiated every term. Nothing super fancy. So this is a very standard technique when you have nonlinear PDs. You differentiate twice the PD, and now I have a linear PD. Look at this term. So forget about the rest, but this is a linear, so if you think of this as a matrix of coefficients, this is a matrix applied to the hessian of this function. So I have a linear PDE for d phi. So this is a right-hand side, and you think of this also as a kind of right-hand side. So the term where there are more derivatives is this one, where there are four derivatives of phi. But this is like a matrix A, so this is a matrix A times the hessian of d phi, which is your function. So you have like a linear PDE on d phi. Okay, but let's forget about that. For these cases, I have nice information. So, f of m is a concave operator It means that this term is a sign. Less or equal than zero. Now you need to compute. So this is always negative. Now one needs to compute what is the gradient of f. So f is the operator. F is a function, right, on the space of matrices, and the operator is log that, log of that of f. So I tell you what it is. So if you do the gradient of f at a matrix m, it is m minus 1. One can check it. It's the inverse of m. So the inverse of log that, the gradient of log that is m minus 1. So now that I have that PD, I will evaluate that at my maximum point, x bar. And so what happens when I evaluate my PD for x equal x bar? At x equal x bar, what do I have? I have a first term which is less or equal than zero. So I get the first term, I will throw it away and keep just inequality. So I have grad f evaluated at the Hessian, but the grad f is the inverse. So I have Hessian of phi of x minus 1 times the Hessian of dEE phi at x bar. And now this term is greater or equal, because I threw away a negative term, to minus 1 plus the Hessian of v at grad phi of x bar applied to grad dE phi at x bar grad dE phi at x bar plus grad v grad phi at x bar times the Hessian of dE phi at x bar. So, yeah?
Is that all the sign correct also the inequality? And the last one is the second derivative of
dE,
or there is a gradient of
dE? Of course, there is a gradient of dE. It doesn't make sense. Yeah. Thank you. So this is dE. Yeah. I took the partial derivative in the E. So this is gradient of dE phi. Yes. Thanks. What was the other question?
The inequality here.
Yeah. So that term plus a negative term was equal to that, which means that this term, if I throw away the negative term, is larger. It's greater or equal. I just throw away the negative. And but now, if I am at x bar, what happens? So phi is convex. So the Hessian of phi is positive definite. And now if you take a matrix which is positive definite, take the inverse, it's still positive definite. So this matrix is positive definite, because it's the inverse of a positive definite matrix. Now, at a maximum point, Hessian of d phi at x bar is negative definite. So this guy is negative definite. And now if you multiply a positive definite and a negative definite, and you sum, I mean, you're taking the sum, so, right? You're taking, this means, so if you, by this notation a dot b, I mean sum over I and j, a I j, b I j. Positive times negative gives negative. Sometimes the notation is also for matrices, people use A, two dots B. I don't know, it's a notation, whatever, I don't care. So here you get a positive definite matrix times a negative definite matrix, you diagonalize one of the two, you do the computation, and you see that this gets negative. Now here, I have an assumption on V. Hessian of V is larger than alpha identity. So this matrix is larger than alpha times identity. And now on the last term, gradient of dE phi is zero. So this term is zero. So at the maximum point, I can, so this is negative. So I get 0 greater or equal than this. Or I take the 1 on the side, and I get 1 greater or equal. So all the other terms disappear. And then I have alpha times the norm of this, gradient of d phi at x bar square, which is larger than alpha d e phi at x bar square, because I'm just taking one component of the gradient. But phi x bar was a maximum point of this. So this is larger, this is equal to alpha times the max over Rn of d e phi of x square. Which implies that if you take, let's say, the sup over x in Rn, and e was an arbitrary vector on the sphere, so e on the sphere, of d e phi of x, oops, this is bounded by 1 over square root of alpha. So you get a uniform bound on the eigenvalues of phi. So you take your phi, your action of the potential of the your convex function, whose gradient gives you the transport map, and then you discover that d e phi is bounded uniformly. If you really look at the paper by Luis, he didn't write it in this way. He wrote it with alpha equal 1. So in his assumption was, this is a Gaussian, and this is a measure log on k where the action is at least the identity. So it's he proved the result when alpha is 1. But the same proof works for every alpha. So if alpha is 1, you see that this tells you that the eigenvalues of your potential are all bounded by 1, in the particular case alpha equal 1. So why this is interesting? There is a very nice application of these two functional inequalities that Luis gave in his paper. And it's really a 2 minutes proof. So I give you this, and then I will spend the last 10 minutes on general cost functions. It can be more general. The only thing you need, so instead of get, this comes one because you had Gaussian. If you put an upper bound on the Hessian, then you get something. Yeah, so the theorem is not written in the most general form. But yeah, you check the proof and it works in much more general situations. So why Luis proved this theorem? He actually had a very nice application to prove. He had several applications. He proved much more than this in the paper. But I think one application that I find it cute is the following one. So, application. You can apply this to prove Poincaré type Poincaré inequalities. So, you say non-fact. So, I will use this notation. So gamma n is the Gaussian measure, cn e to the minus x squared over 2. And then it's a non-fact that the Gaussian measure has a Poincaré inequality. And in fact, what is true is that for every function f such that integral of f times gamma n is 0, so every function f with zero average, the integral of f squared times gamma n is bounded by the integral of grad f squared times gamma n. So this is the Poincaré inequality. The gradient in L2 controls the function in L2 for all function with zero mean. And the constant here is 1 for every dimension. So it's not that I forgot the constant. That's the right constant, 1. Okay, now I take take T, the optimal transport from gamma n to e to the minus v, where Hessian of v is larger than alpha identity. So I consider T the optimal transport. And then I notice the following. So T, remember, is gradient of phi. And phi satisfies the property we just showed. So the Hessian of phi has eigenvalues bounded by 1 over square root of alpha. Now, given G such that G has measure 0, G has average 0 with respect to the measure e to the minus v. So if you take a G which has average 0, you would like to prove a Poincaré inequality for G. Now, so you like to have here put G, G and G, but with the measure, not the measure, the Gaussian measure, but with the measure e to the minus v. But now this is what? This is the integral of G times T push forward of gamma n. So I can write this as the integral of G composition T times gamma n. Now this becomes my F, to which I'm going to apply Poincaré inequality. So I can apply Poincaré inequality by Poincaré for gamma n. I have that the integral of G composition T square is bounded times gamma n, is bounded by the integral of gradient of G composition T square times gamma n. So I just applied, right, Poincaré inequality to the composition. But this is, by the push forward, this is exactly equal to the integral of G square T push forward gamma n is e to the minus v. So the left-hand side exactly gives me what I wanted. So the square of G with respect to my original measure. What about here? Here is the gradient of the composition. Now, if you develop this, this is the integral of the modulus of the gradient of G composed with T times gradient of T square gamma n. So you see, at every point, what I'm doing, what is here? This is, you're taking gradient of T, so it's the Hessian of phi. So you're taking the Hessian of phi at the point x, applied to the vector grad g at the point t of x. And then you're taking the norm of this vector. Right? Here I have exactly this. This is this, and this is this. So I'm taking a vector, I'm applying a matrix to it, and I compute the norm. But now this matrix has eigenvalues which are all bounded by 1 over square root of alpha. So at most, if I take a matrix with eigenvalues bounded by 1 over square root of alpha and apply a vector to it, at most this matrix can dilate this vector by that size. So the modulus of this pointwise is bounded by 1 over square root of alpha, the norm of this vector. And then I substitute here. So this is, here I have a square. So I get 1 over alpha integral of grad g composed with t square gamma n. And now I can apply the push forward condition. 1 over alpha integral of grad g square e to the minus v. So what this proves, if you give me any measure which has, if you take a measure of the form e to the minus v, where v is uniformly convex, then e to the minus v satisfies Poincaré inequality with constant 1 over alpha. So we prove the Poincaré inequality for every measure like this. I mean, this was already known before Lewis, of course. I think this proof is particularly interesting. It's very flexible and is actually very short. So I like it. So essentially, it's a proof that allows you to transfer information from the Gaussian measure to more general measures. I have an inequality for the Gaussian measure, like Poincaré or something like that, I can prove that the same is true for the measure e to the minus v. And actually, the constant is sharp, so you cannot do better. But 1 over alpha is sharp. So it's really optimal. Okay. So very briefly, what happens if you change costs now? So when you change costs, life becomes much more complicated. The reason is that your Monge-Ampère equation actually becomes an equation of this form. So let me just try to show you the formulas a bit. So general cost. So in general cost, what you can do is the following. You say, OK, I have the Jacobian equation, determinant of grad t is f over g composition f. Sorry, g composition t. But now, t is not given as anymore as before by the gradient of a convex function. There is a more complicated relation, which was that the gradient of phi plus the gradient with respect to x of c of x t of x is equal to 0. This was the relation between the potential and the transport. Okay, differentiate this. Let's differentiate. Take a gradient with respect to x. What do you get? You get the Hessian of phi plus, when you differentiate, the derivative either falls on the first component or on the second component. So you get grad x, x of c at x d of x when the derivative goes on this variable, or the derivative goes on the second variable, and you get grad xy of c of x t of x times the gradient of t at x equals 0. So this is the relation, which means you put grad t on the other side, you get grad t of x equal. Okay, let's do it this way. We take these two guys, we take them on the other side, so to keep only this term. So you get minus dx x phi minus grad x, okay, let's put the minus outside, dx x phi plus grad x x of c of x t of x. And now, here, grad t is multiplied by this matrix, and I'm going to multiply on the other side by the inverse. So I get minus, and then I get grad x, y, c, inverse. So this matrix before was multiplying this matrix here. I just multiply by the inverse to put it on the other side. And now you just have a formula for grad t that you can take and plug inside. So what happens is that when you take the determinant here, you get the determinant. So remember, determinant of the product is the product of the determinants. So that you get the determinant of dxx phi plus grad xx of c of x t of x equal. So you have f over g composition t. And then you have the determinant of this, which you can put in on the other side, so you get the determinant of grad x, y of c, evaluated at x, t of x. This is the kind of formula you get. And finally, the last thing you can do is to remember that t of x was y of x and grad phi. So whenever there is a t of x, you can express it as a function of x and grad phi. So you can kind of insert this. And so here you will have, instead of t of x, y of x grad phi. Here y of x grad phi, and here y of x grad phi. So instead, so you see that you get a bit of a monster equation. It's very ugly. I mean, to be honest, I wouldn't. So you get an equation like this. So, sorry, give me 5 minutes and then. So determinant of d square phi plus, so here you get something which will depend on x angle phi. I will call it A of x grad phi equal to something right hand side which depends on x angle phi. Doesn't matter too much the formula. Okay, so all this expression, all the other terms depends on x and grad phi in some form. Okay, and now when you try to work on this equation, the first thing you can try to do is, when you want to understand the PDE, is to do exactly the same computation as Ruiz did for the contraction theorem. Differentiate the equation twice and try to understand what happens when you get the equation for the second derivatives. So if you differentiate the PDE twice, you get a lot of terms, and many are bad. But there is one particular term which will be your enemy. And this is the one when you differentiate A twice. So when you differentiate in X, there will be a moment where the derivative falls on this, in X. And so you will have a term like d square of A, at evaluated at X grad phi, applied, and then the derivative was falling on this. So this will be like gradient d phi, gradient d phi. So among all the terms, there will be one like this. And this term, so you remember one crucial thing for Caffarelli proof was to say, oh, log of that is concave, so one of the terms has a sign. Let's throw it away. Here you have this extra term that you don't see in Monge-Ampere that you don't know how to handle unless it has a sign. So you need to assume that this term has a sign. So you assume that this term has the right sign to do what you want to do. And this is what people call the MTW condition, due to Ma, Trudinger, and Wong. Okay? So they introduced this condition, which looked very artificial, and they said, okay, if this condition is satisfied, then I can repeat a lot of things I can do with Monge-Ampere. If it's not satisfied, I don't know what to do. So this was in 2005. But then, 3-4 years later, Grégoire Lepère, working on this problem, he said, oh, if MTW fails, then there exist counterexamples. Which means it doesn't matter what assumption you put on F and G, convexity of the support, F and G super smooth, everything you want, it doesn't matter. If MTW fails, I can find super nice densities for which the transport map is not even continuous. So this goes beyond the geometry. It really is something structural of the cost. So you need the cost. So A depends on the cost, and you need the cost to satisfy this condition in order to have regularity. So then there has been a lot of work in this direction. What can you do when there is MTW? What you cannot do when there is MTW? Like, can you do partial regularity? Like the one that we did with Yang and Kim. So for instance, there is a paper of myself with Guido De Filippis where we did it partial regularity without any MTW. But let's say there is a lot of open, very interesting questions in this direction, which is also very challenging. If you're interested, actually have some survey notes. Particularly, there is a paper on the bulletin AMS 2015 by De Filippis and myself. So this is a survey where we kind of explain a bit in general the regularity theory. We mentioned this optimal transport, we mentioned this MTW, and you can find more and also a list of open problems. So I think I'm out of time, so I stop here. Thank you.
very much for a very nice lecture. Are there any questions? I was a bit confused about your statement that alpha is actually optimal in this Poincaré quality. What sense is that to you?
What I mean, I don't know, if you take the Gaussian, if you just rescale the Gaussian, so one is optimal for the Gaussian, right? And then if I take e to the minus v, like, maybe I'm saying, I didn't check much, but to be honest, I didn't check, but it looked very optimal. I will guess that if I take e to the minus alpha x squared over 2 as a measure, then the optimal transport is like alpha times identity, and the Poincaré constant for that, it's 1 over alpha.
That's right, but that's not the same statement as saying I give you a v, you compute the alpha, and alpha is optimal for this v.
It's no.
Just to define the v for that
alpha. No. Let's say, no, okay, yeah. It depends how you say it, but yeah, what I meant is like in the set of potential, I mean, if you give me only this information, let's say you look at all the measures which satisfy this, then this is the best constant you can put. Of course, maybe there are V's which satisfy that and they have better Poincaré constant than 1 over alpha. Yeah, sure. Thanks.
Any other questions or comments?
Yeah.
How would you transform the geometry to a statement?
So, okay, so there is a geometric statement here in the sense that MTW is a condition on the cost. So when you express it, so here is not clear what the formula is, but you can write it down. It's a condition on third and fourth derivatives of the cost. So you write it and there is, it's kind of ugly, but it's a long tensor and there is an inequality. Now, if you work on manifolds, so if you are X and Y are subset of a manifold, M, Riemannian manifold, and the cost Cxy is equal to the squared Riemannian distance, then your condition on the cost becomes a condition on the distance of the manifold, which becomes a condition on the geometry of the manifold, because it's something about D. And now MTW is something about four derivatives of the distance, is actually stronger. So MTW implies that the sectional curvature of M is non-negative at every point. So it's like to compute sectional curvature, what do? You take a point on the manifold, you start to compute the Riemann curvature tensor, which is a complicated expression in terms of four derivatives of the metric, and then you get some object, a tensor. You can do the same with MTW, which is an object which depends even on more parameters, because there is this variable, this is a matrix, and there are two more variables. So it's still a four tensor, but it's even more involved than the Riemann tensor. And then MTW condition becomes a geometric condition on the manifold, which is stronger than sectional curvature. So actually, this is an observation, a very nice observation by Grégoire Lepère, which has a nice corollary that Lepère said if MTW fails, there exist counterexamples. So this means that if you give me a Riemannian manifold such that at one point the sectional curvature is negative, then there is a counterexample to the regularity. You only need it to fail at one point. So either your manifold is super round as you can think, like sphere, or not much more, otherwise MTW will fail. So it's a very rigid condition. Most manifolds do not satisfy MTW.
No, I actually also wanted to ask you about this. So what are really the results and what are the counterexamples, but maybe you partially already answered this.
Yeah, so MTW is true. Okay, so on cost, there are examples like cost, like there have been interesting costs that can satisfy it. But let's think in terms of manifold. Probably it's easier to give examples. So you take a manifold, you take as cost the Riemannian distance squared, then you ask which manifold satisfy MTW. So MTW is satisfied, by Rn, fine, the sphere, perturbations of the sphere, so the round metric, or you can take the sphere and you perturb it like C infinity, still satisfies. This is actually very highly non-trivial. You can take quotients, you can take, I don't know, CPN, complex projective space, real projective space, RPN, and not much more. Products. Yeah, exactly.
This is what you mean by the contraction result.
No, okay, these are two different things, right? So the contraction result is really something very, very strong, which is point-wise, it tells you the action is bounded. And the amazing thing about the contraction result is that it's a bound independent of the dimension. So it's 1 over alpha, doesn't matter which dimension you are. So this is one problem. But I was just making a parallel in terms of the technique. In both cases, you differentiate the PD twice. But then the techniques are completely different because that proof works only for the Gaussian, the one I gave by Caffarelli. Here, the point is like, okay, you take, I don't know, the sphere. You take very smooth, nice, positive density on the sphere. The transport map is smooth. So on the sphere, you can do optimal transport, and it works nicely. You take our Earth, on where we live. It's clearly a C4 perturbation of the sphere. And then if true, if you model our Earth as a C4 perturbation of the sphere, then MTW is true. I didn't check the curvature of the sphere enough. But let's say essentially on the sphere is fine, Rn is fine, this is fine. So it means that if you have nice positive density, you have smoothness, as smooth as you can. But the moment it fails, like hyperbolic space, no regularity. Not even continuity, no matter how nice it is. But you have partial regularity. So the theorem that I stated, the one with the Young-Yeon, works also in this case. So you have to remove two sets of measure zero. Outside is a smooth diffeomorphism without any assumption on MTW.
So is there any element of Caffarelli's contractor theorem on manifolds?
Good question. One could, I never thought about that, and I've never seen it. So let's say if you take manifold which satisfies MTW, because MTW is going to appear when you do Caffarelli and then you will have extra terms, you may hope to do something. Now, the problem is that this is just one of the terms. I never checked what the other terms give, right? Because then when you differentiate, you get many more terms, right? Because it's not only F and G. You have this now when you differentiate, which is ugly as well. The point is of this MTW is that many terms are there, but you can absorb them in some way. You can treat them as lower order terms. This term, you cannot treat it as a lower order term, and that's the enemy. But then doing Caffarelli is a bit magical. All the terms disappear, and there is just one greater or equal than something else without errors. On a manifold, I see it diffuse. Maybe on the sphere. It would be interesting to check. Maybe a product of sphere times something. Could be an interesting thing to check.
Any further questions or comments? Well, if not, then let's thank Alessio for the good questions. We start the workshop at 2.
Thanks a lot, beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. That was fun.